Here we go again, as simple as possible, as soon as possible, A&P. Chapter 12, continued here, very general structure of the brain. It's the second part of it all. Here we got it. Last time we were together, we talked about rostral and caudal and the 12 pairs of cranial nerve, and we did silly things to help you remember how to remember. Then we went back and talked about a major landmark, such as the longitudinal fissure, transverse fissure, central sulcus, lateral sulcus, and the pre- and post-central gyrus. Gee, I hope it said something about the post-central gyrus. But these things right here are the major landmarks that help us find things later on inside the brain. We talked about sulci and gyri and fissure. We talked about the four major parts of the brain. We talked about the five major lobes of each cerebral hemisphere, and that was frontal, parietal, occipital, temporal, and then the insula, which is sort of hidden in a fold right here, deep inside the lateral sulcus. Here's the longitudinal fissure. There's the corpus callosum connecting the two cerebral hemispheres, which if you look at the cortex material, kind of sort of takes on an E and a 3 kind of a pattern to it. And then these islands right here of gray matter are called nuclei. So the cortex is along the edge, like the crust of a loaf of bread, and the nuclei are islands towards the middle. The rest of this stuff right here, which isn't gray, is white matter, and it's generally axons sending signals around. We talked about the dural sinus, created by the dura mater when it jumps over the longitudinal fissure, and the periosteal layer of the dura mater separates from the meningeal layer, and you create this little strange triangular space. That right there is going to be called a dural sinus, but it's also known as the superior sagittal sinus. This gives a little wedgie effect going down into the longitudinal fissure. It hits the corpus callosum, turns around and comes back up and creates another little triangular gutter space right there. And that right there would be the inferior sagittal sinus. Both of these things used by the venous blood as gutters, as veins, draining blood away from the brain. We talked about the dural folds, so being wedgies in the longitudinal fissure and the transverse fissure and in some other regions. We talked about a cutaway view right here in which we saw the thalamus, the hypothalamus, the infundibulum, and the pituitary gland. We saw the location of the fourth ventricle right here. We talked about a traumatic brain injury, concussions, contusions, hemorrhage, hematoma, and epidural and subdural hematoma, and some of the problems they create with nervous tissue. We also talked about meningitis and hydrocephalus real quickly. We identified the four major ventricles of the brain, the two lateral ventricles divided by the septum pellucidum. They're found inside the cerebral hemispheres. Then the third ventricle is inside the diencephalon. The third looks like a bird. Then right here is the fourth ventricle, which is located between the pons and the cerebellum. And it kind of looks like a kite, or it's the body of this scrawny little bird right here. So you got two laterals, a third, and a fourth. And then it connects down to the central canal of the spinal cord. Now, these things are filled with cerebral spinal fluid, and the cerebral spinal fluid is made from blood at the choroid plexus inside the ventricles of the brain. The fluid moves into the subarachnoid spaces and down eventually into the central canal of the spinal cord. But they all come back to the subarachnoid spaces, go to the top of the brain right there at the superior sagittal sinus, where there are arachnoid villi, which allow the fluid to move back into the blood. So you borrow from the blood, you return to the blood approximately half a liter per day, the volume going through there. We did talk ever so quickly about the fact that blood vessels inside your brain have an extra layer on the outside of them called the blood-brain barrier, BBB, created by the perivascular feed of the astrocytes. They're found on the outside of the simple squamous epithelium that makes up the capillaries. So getting something out of the circulating blood into the central nervous system is not easy. The astrocytes have to let that happen. Well, new stuff right down here goes to this. Let's talk about the fact that, of course, you have two cerebral hemispheres connected by a corpus callosum right there. Well, it turns out when you were very, very young, each cerebral hemisphere pretty much had the same talents. as the other cerebral hemisphere. So each one could have pretty much control the entire body. But as you get older, each side begins to specialize. And so we call that lateralization. So, for example, each side might be able to organize something, but one does it in a very linear and logical way, and the other one does it in a kind of conceptual way. So, here is a very, very general explanation of some of the special talents associated with each cerebral hemisphere. The left cerebral hemisphere is basically about logic and language and logarithms. It is very exacting. It's the engineer side of the brain. So for it, 2 + 2 = 4, and that is it. There's no discussion. It is noetic. That is, it is very exacting. It deals with reason. It deals with logic. It loves math because of all the organization. It loves the organization of language, like grammar and such. And because of something called decussation, the qualities of the left side of the brain, the left cerebral hemisphere, well, the left cerebral hemisphere projects itself over to the right side of the body. So a person who is left-brained is very often right-handed. So right-handed people, in our very general explanation right here, tend to live more so on the left side of their brain, linear, logical. Okay, on the right side of the brain, okay, when we talk about mathematics, 2 + 2 is more than 2. It's many, it's several, it's not as exacting. And so the concept is concepts, it's conceptual. This person in the math class, using their left brain, will do the work, show their work, and get the right answer. This person in the math class will do the work, not necessarily show their work, but still possibly come up with the right answer. Math teachers tend to be over here, and some really good students who annoy math teachers are sometimes found over here. Over here we said things are more poetic than noetic. Poetic, you say things that aren't grammatically correct, or that wasn't the only word or best word that you could have used for it, but the concept is there. Here's rhyme, there's reason. Over here there's a whimsy that goes along with trying to explain things. Over here, you use logic to come up with an answer. Over here, sometimes you just have a hunch. And that hunch, sort of like in mathematics, sometimes is absolutely right. Over here, you go for concepts, and over here, you go for exacting things. So this is a more kind of a open-minded, if you want to say that, freelance kind of a way of looking at things, not nearly so rigid as the right side, left side, excuse me. The right side right here is Rousseau and rhetoric and Renaissance. So, because of decussation, people who are right-brained are sometimes left-handed. And that begins to explain a little bit of the personality that people sometimes attribute to left-handed people, being somehow slightly different in the way that they handle things and conceptualize things. Of course, considering that the world's engineers, being often right-handed, create the doors and the scissors and the desk and everything, and these people have to handle it, even though this is a right-handed world created by some engineers. Here's a left-handed person trying to live in it. They have to know how to be adaptive and be creative. When it comes to building things, a grossly oversimplified example would be an engineer would work on this side. An architect might work on this side right here. So the architect is going for the beauty and the flow and things that catch your emotions. The engineer is trying to make something that is waterproof and doesn't fall down. Decussation, by the way, happens usually inside the area of the medulla, and it's a great little word because decussation comes from the word deca. And deca means 10, and the Roman numeral for 10 is an X. And so over here you have a crossing over. So with this in mind, this says that if you had damage to, say, the left cerebral hemisphere, say a stroke, very often the result of that damage is seen on the right side of the body. This crossing over means that damage to the left side is often seen on the right side of the body and vice versa. Also, sometimes when there's damage, say, to the left cerebral hemisphere, you can almost draw a line down the body, and on one side, everything's fine, but on the other side, there are problems. When it comes to trying to visualize how much brain space is utilized for different parts of the body, something called a homunculus is sometimes used. again, a very right-brained attitude. And that is to draw a cartoon and to exaggerate the body parts to represent what has more brain space associated with it. So this is a horribly oversimplified one, but there's a great deal of brain space associated with the eyes and eye movement, with the mouth, lips, and tongue, and with the hands. But not so much, say, for arms, elbows, the trunk, legs, and knee. So this is just a quick way to point out that there is a lot of space dedicated to these regions of the body, but not so much there. One way to remember this is, if you had just a little bitty sore on your tongue, in your imagination, it might be huge, but the same size sore, say on your calf, might not get much attention whatsoever. Okay, next thing right here, let's go over and look at this view of the brain. We have the frontal lobe, parietal lobe, occipital lobe, and temporal lobe. Then down in here, we have the insula. If we are trying to locate where some of the major senses of the body are found, okay, your sense of touch is very often associated with your parietal lobe. Sense of hearing and smell with your temporal lobe, vision, the occipital, and taste and memory down here inside the insula. The frontal lobe doesn't have much to do when it comes to sensations, but this is in many ways the civilized part of your brain, most civilized part of your brain. This is where your thinking, your reasoning happens to be. All right, keep on moving ever so quickly, but let's get a little bit more exacting. Over here is a more exacting kind of a map. Here we have the frontal lobe, the parietal lobe, the occipital lobe, the temporal lobe, and there is the central sulcus right there. Well, in the precentral gyrus, you have what's called the motor cortex. The motor cortex is where signals are sent out to your skeletal muscles to command your skeletal muscles what they should do. So the decision to move those muscles wasn't made here, but that's where the commands are sent out. It is a motor region of your brain. This one right here, the postcentral gyrus, is sometimes known as the primary somatosensory cortex. This is where you receive signals from your body parts, particularly your joints, tendons, ligaments, muscle capsules, and such. Those special mechanoreceptors are called proprioceptors, and altogether, these signals help you create a body image. So you know where your body parts are because these things are reporting in. So right now, if you're thinking about where your toes are and if they're close together or not, just wiggle your toes. The proprioceptors will report in right here. You'll create a body image. Now you remember where your toes are. When you wake up in the morning, very often people will stretch to cause their proprioceptors to report right here, and you draw your body image. Now you know where your center of gravity is, and when you stand up, you won't stumble so much. If you're separated from your proprioceptors, if you separate your proprioceptors from your primary somatosensory cortex, then you don't know where your body parts are. And this sometimes happens when you get hit in the head or when a person's intoxicated. A person who is drunk doesn't really know where their feet are. Even though signals are being sent towards your brain can't unscramble them, doesn't know where your feet are, so you shouldn't be trying to walk home. You shouldn't be trying to drive home. Yeah, you're in bad shape. And you definitely don't know where the tip of your finger is and where your nose is, and a police officer might ask you to sort of prove something. On this side right here, that was the motor cortex where you sent signals out to your skeletal muscles, but here is where the decision was made. This is called the premotor cortex. This is where you decide which skeletal muscles will be moved to cross your fingers or to hold up three fingers or four fingers, to interlace your fingers, to move around. All those decisions are made right here. This is the region of the brain that a coach is trying to talk to when they're trying to get you to understand how to hold a bowling ball or a baseball bat or something like that. Now, uniquely down here is a special area just below the premotor cortex, and it's called Broca's area. And Broca's area is where you specifically help decide how to control the skeletal muscles involved in speech. So those muscles that are involved in creating the sounds associated with speech. Now, this is the area where you do or don't know how to make certain sounds, such as, in a word such as burrito, some folks are able to take the R in the middle and roll that thing, and it just goes burrito. But obviously, somebody like me can't. That's the reason. The reason for that basically is when I was young and my Broca's air was being formed and sort of set in place, I didn't have that sound in my language, in my vocabulary. But folks who speak Spanish do. And so therefore they learn that sound. And after the age of 7, you're pretty much fixed on those particular sounds you can make. So there are certain sounds, say in Chinese and Japanese and Korean, that are difficult for English-speaking people to make if they weren't introduced to it when they were very, very young. A unique little idea here is, in Swedish, there's about 60 plus different sounds associated with Swedish. If you learn Swedish when you're a child, you have so many opportunities to learn these different sounds that when you learn foreign languages, you probably will do a much better job of not having some grotesque American or Chinese or German or other kind of accent. Okay. Over here is called Wernicke's area. In Wernicke's area, you try to organize the pattern of your speech. Here, you try to use the muscles to make the sounds. Over here, you try to organize the pattern of the speech. You put the words in their proper space, place. You try to put subject, verb, predicate kind of a thing. You put adjectives in front of the noun, not after it. And of course, in each one of the languages, there's different grammar techniques, and you train this thing for those different grammar techniques. Wernicke's area. If something goes wrong right here, you know what you're hearing, you know what you want to say, but you can't really say it. You babble. Over here, you can hear what people are saying, you can understand it, but when you just try to say something, you can't put the words in the right order. Let me slide on down here and take a look at this picture again. This is emphasizing the same thing. Again, auditory and olfactory are located in the temporal lobe. Vision is located back here. Sense of touch is up in this region right here where the somatosensory regions are located. Here's Wernicke's area. There's Broca's area. Here's the precentral cortex. There's the motor cortex right there. And then deep inside the gustatory area, which is taste. So gustatory refers to taste. Over here, it's talking about the fact that, well, with each sensory area, such as visual, there is an association area. So visual cortex, visual association cortex. The visual cortex receives signals from your eyes, but it doesn't understand them. It just receives them as if to say something came in. The visual association area puts meaning to what just came in. So if you see a line like this right here, the visual cortex just has a signal that something is there. This is the area where it interprets that symbol as a V or a check or a 7 or a nose or whatever it wants it to be. So this is where you put a name to an image. This is where the image comes in. If you had a TV set that had a broken screen, you could receive the signal, but you wouldn't get the image. And that's what this is about too. Here is the auditory cortex and the auditory association cortex. The auditory cortex receives signals from your ear, but does not understand them. The auditory association area is where you put meaning to those sounds. So this receives a signal from your ear saying something's happening. This one right here says, well, no, that is a middle C on a piano, or it is the voice of your child, or something along that line. Okay. Now, putting all this information together is this region right here called the gnostic region. The general gnostic region up here is where you try to take several different sources of information and interpretations and come up with one general picture. The word gnostic refers to knowledge, and you can remember the word agnostic, meaning not having knowledge, not knowing whether there's a God or not. Well, gnostic says you know something. You're putting the information together. And this is very much where your cleverness comes in or your confusion. Before I run out of battery right here, here's another thing to take a look at, and that is when it comes to different regions of your brain communicating with each other, some fibers, some connections are completely inside one cerebral hemisphere. They're called association fibers. If they cross over to the other hemisphere, they're called commensural fibers. And if they project from the cerebral hemisphere down to the body, they're called projection fibers. And these make up the white matter of the brain. The commensural fibers, by the way, are very abundant in the corpus callosum, where the two cerebral hemispheres try to talk to each other and, back to here, try to get the two sides to work with both concepts and logic at the same time. By the way, if you are left brain, you might be right-handed. If you're right-brained, you might be left-handed, but of course, you are both at the same time. You do use both sides of your brain. And if you're not exactly right or left-handed, you're ambidextrous. So you can be ambidextrous in your brain just like you can be in your hands. I'm running out of battery.